Would you like to accelerate your career and reach your full potential in just minutes a day? Welcome to the LEADx Show with New York Times bestselling author and Inc. 500 entrepreneur, Kevin Kruse.
How do you handle a boss who keeps calling you after hours? How often should you give your employees thank you notes? Hello, everyone. I'm Kevin Kruse. Welcome to the LEADx Show, helping you to stand out and to get ahead. Today, it's the weekly show, so we are broadcasting live to our Facebook audience. Podcast listeners, if you want to be notified when we go live on Facebook, just go to LEADx Life and like the page and turn on notifications. And with the weekly wrap-up show, this is the day we take our time. We get to rant about miscellaneous stuff or whatever's on our mind. We take your questions and try to answer them. And of course, I'm also joined by LEADx editor Tara Millette. Hi, Tara.
Hello, everyone.
How's it going?
Pretty good. You know, I can't really complain. This week has been nice and productive, but I'm more interested in hearing how you're doing because you had a big deadline or have a big deadline.
Yes.
Coming up.
So for those who haven't been following along in my agony, I've got a book deadline, which is tomorrow, with a publisher for my next leadership book. It doesn't come out till 2018. The traditional publishers are so slow. But anyway, draft one is due tomorrow. And I now have 6 of 10 chapters done.
Yay!
So that's yay, there's 6. That is definitely the glasses 6/10 full. I like that.
There you go.
It's hard not to focus on the 4 chapters that just aren't done, but I'm trying. I'm getting there. For some reason, for this book, I don't exactly know why, but it's just been harder to get into the zone. And I think I'm distracted. There's all these other things, including this podcast and other things I'm working on. It's exciting. But, you know, I was procrastinating on the book yesterday, Tara.
And I remember.
Like every paragraph or two, I procrastinate and I stop and I do something. I don't know why. Really bad. Because I'm the guy that's like, hey, here's how you solve procrastination. I've been procrastinating. And I grab a random book off my bookshelf and I open it up. And this just happened last night. It made a reference about like someone going for the brass ring, like trying to grab the brass ring. And you've heard that phrase, right? Like,
yeah.
It means like you're going for it. You're trying to get it all, right? That kind of thing. Well, I knew that phrase. But all of a sudden I stopped and I thought, where did that phrase come from? And I didn't know. Like, do you know where that phrase came from?
My first thought is always that, you know, it's some kind of athletic Olympic kind of going full bore thing where you know, an obstacle course or something and you have to reach up and grab that.
So you, like me, have no idea where the phrase grab the brass ring
comes from. I was so hoping to be a secret genius about these. All right.
You know, I'm 50 years old, hate to say it. And I'm like, how did I never wonder where that phrase, like, where did it come from? So I found out, of course, instead of writing my book, instead of writing chapter 7, I start Googling, right?
Good.
And it turns out that it has to do with the history of carousels, merry-go-rounds. And there used to be like regular merry-go-rounds. You go round and round and then up and down. They kept making them fancier because people were getting bored with the carousels. And then what they started to do was there was – like I always imagined like you did. Like the brass ring is like a big thing that you grab onto. Well, it's a little like device that puts out a regular-sized ring. And as you go on the merry-go-round, the riders are supposed to try to catch it. It's like hard to catch. You got to lean out and try to catch the ring. And most of them are not brass rings. They're just regular, I don't know, lead. And so you grab those and they're like, that's the loser prize. Or sometimes you would throw it at targets or something. But every now and then it would be the brass ring. And then everybody is like way like falling off their horse on the carousel trying to grab the brass ring. And if you got the brass ring, you know what you won?
The brass ring?
No, you had to get it. It was valuable, made of brass. All you got was another ride on the carousel.
No. This carousel sounds like a crazy obstacle course. I had no idea they were so extreme.
They talked about when they first started this thing, people were like freaking out. They're stressed. They're getting hurt, falling off the ride, trying to get the brass ring. Yeah. And of course, you know, me overthinking everything, I'm like, Is this like an obvious metaphor, how like in life we're, instead of just enjoying the ride and the wind on our face and laughing with our friends, we're like stretching and we're stressed and we're trying to grab the brass ring. And then when we get it, all we get is another round on the carousel.
And then you just keep trying to get that ring again, right?
Exactly. Like, come on, guys, get off the rat race, right? Like, it, I guess it's just like enjoy the, it's about the road, it's about the journey, not the destination. It's about the carousel, not the brass ring. I don't know. That's what I always say.
That is so wild. I had no idea.
So I want to know from the audience members, like the podcasters. So did you guys know what this brass ring came from? Like, go grab, like, I didn't know. Am I the only one? Are we the only two?
Anyway. I mean, I just assumed it was some kind of trapeze act.
I thought it was a giant ring you would grab. Yeah, I don't. I'm mad that I never knew all this. Okay, but here's to beat a dead horse further. Guess what, Tara? There's only like one or two antique carousels that still have this brass ring that you can grab. And one of them is at an amusement park that's about 50 miles from Philadelphia. So I might go and ride this thing and try to grab the brass ring.
You may have entered into an expert procrastinator zone, because it sounds like you went real deep into this rabbit hole.
I know. All right. So when I finish my book, I'm going to shave and then I'm going to go try to grab the brass ring, but not before then.
I like that. All right. Yeah.
All right.
Maybe the whole LEADx team can join you.
That's my rant of the week.
Carousels.
Carousels. More important. Mm-hmm. We have a review of the week, an iTunes podcast review of the week.
We sure do. This one is from TDelg08872.
Lovely name.
Which sounds like a lovely robot name. and this is what TDelg had to say. I recently became a director in my organization, and I can tell you that day one, I was scared about the position, as I have never been a manager before. But after listening to Kevin for a few weeks in a row, I've learned so much about leadership and most importantly about myself, and I have come to realize that I am a leader by nature. It almost feels like sorcery when each day he seems to be talking about something that I am struggling with specifically, and after the podcast, I have the right tool in my hand to take action. Thanks, Kevin. If you can, please send me an invite to your Facebook page. I would love to be on the club. And thanks again. And I am looking forward to hearing more and to share this with my peers.
Awesome.
Excellent review. And I have to say, yeah, I have the same thing happen. You know, if ever I'm kind of plagued by self-doubt, that'll be the day that I'm, you know, reading the interview with Cam Awesome or something, you know?
That's cool.
So that's a really great review. TDelg0872. Please reach out to info@leadx.org. We'd love to send you one of these awesome t-shirts that we are wearing right now as a thank you for that review. And everyone, please feel free to go to the iTunes and rate and review the show, because we'll give you a shout out and maybe a mug or a t-shirt or two.
Love it. And I want to remind everyone that they can also get our free ebook, Richard Branson's 7 Secrets to Leadership, by going to leadx.org/Branson. And of course, I know everybody wants more LEADx in their life. So just go to LEADx Life on Twitter, Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. Follow us everywhere. Whew, that's good.
We're everywhere. Yeah, that's great. So I think it's question time.
All right. What do we got?
So actually, first, we have a few comments from some challenges that a few of our listeners accepted and crushed. So I'm going to look through those. And I also want to remind anyone on the Facebook Live video, feel free to ask questions now if you'd like. And if we have enough time, we can answer them a little later on.
Perfect.
All right. So the first challenge is Jessica Peters. And she took on the challenge from Dr. Michael Bruce, which is a great interview. If anyone's listening or watching, I recommend it. Yeah, he's the sleep doctor. And he talks about different chronotypes, about if you're a lion or a bear or a wolf or a dolphin, and it all has to do with what's your optimal schedule. So this is what Jessica had to say about that. My favorite part of this week was Monday. I found out the best time for me to be productive and tried switching my routine up for the week. It actually made a difference. Even with me not feeling well this week, I was super productive. Thank you for the insights. Jessica Peters.
That's awesome. I know our listeners like these online quizzes and things. I wasn't sure how many people did the did the sleep one. I mean, it's great to try to match like our productive stuff with our peak energy levels and everything. I think that's brilliant. That's good.
Yeah, Jessica, I'd love it if you could reach out. I'm curious what chronotype she got, right?
Right.
Because yeah. I think what they say, half of the population is usually a bear. You are? Are you?
Yeah.
You're a wolf or are you a lion?
I can't remember now. When you said half was a bear, I thought I was a bear, but now I don't remember from that interview.
I think I remember you were a lion. I'm not sure, but you were like a early to rise, to bed, something like that. Yeah. But it's a really interesting interview, so I recommend it. Another challenge was from Eddie Arrieta, and he says, I only took on two challenges. Well, that's very great, Eddie, so don't worry about that. One, no more late emails. Two, 3x3 challenge on Fridays. It is on my calendar, and I'm actively taking 1 hour starting today to connect 6 members of my community. FYI, love the daily email, sweet and short. Thank you, Eddie. That's a great compliment, actually, to me, because I am responsible for the daily emails. anyone out there who has any suggestions, feel free to reach out to me, tara@leadx.org. I'm happy to take any constructive criticism. But that's great. And the challenges that Eddie is referencing is the Maura Thomas talks about late night emails and how those can affect your team. And the 3x3 challenge is super interesting. That's from Tim Sanders. And he talked about connecting 3 people in your network with another 3 people in your network once a week.
So this is, well, and first of all, I wanted to remind all the listeners, like we certainly ask our guests about, you know, how to challenge us. But if you subscribe to our email newsletter, then every day you get this challenge in your email inbox. You just open up in the morning, see what the daily challenge is, and that helps you to get 1% better every single day. So I encourage everybody to do that. I had actually, again, with all the interviews, I'd sort of forgotten about that. But that late night email one, I'm not perfect at it, but it really did change my behaviors. I mean, I went from emailing people, and I think we're going to have a question on this actually in a second. Mm-hmm. But, I used to bother all of you team members all the time, 24/7. And then it was like, I would do it, but I would tell you guys, oh, you know, don't worry about answering. I'm just doing it for myself. And then, you know, she really opened my eyes. Like, you can tell people to ignore it, but they're going to be stressing about it. It still compels them to open up on the weekend. So I've been trying to be better, not perfect. And Katrina just sent me a note. She says, I'm a lion.
Aha. That's nice. I just hibernate and eat all the time, apparently. That's my chronotype, is lazy. You get a cool animal, king of the cats. I get deep winter hibernation.
Just remind us of that every Monday when I go around and say, hey, so how was your week? And you're like, I'm still hibernating.
When the winter comes, you'll never see me. I'll just be stuck in my room under my blankets for a good 6 months. Great. Okay, so let's move on to one of these questions here. As you mentioned, it's going to be about emails. So this is from Rin. Recently, I started a new career and just passed the probation period. My new boss is very active and always puts on a lot of pressure. Quite often, he calls my personal mobile phone after working hours when I leave the office to catch up with or assign something to me. I couldn't let it go and had to keep picking up the phone. I tried to get used to this working style, but I end up feeling stressed. I would like to know, how can I handle the situation better? Great question.
Yeah, Tara, this actually, I mean, it's different, but it reminded me of what you asked last week about, you know, your friend who all of a sudden the boss is expecting everybody to stay later and later and is kind of hanging around. And I wasn't like thrilled with my answer last week, and it was kind of kicking around in my head. And, you know, this is a similar thing where you've got, you know, your boss or the company that's expecting you to work, you know, late at night or on weekends. And it also triggered this specific question. When I sold, the first company I sold was actually my third company. The first two went bankrupt. My third company, I was 30 years old, sold it and became like a top partner in this new company, reporting to the CEO. And right away, I mean, he was like calling, you know, 10 o'clock at night routinely. I can remember it was like a Saturday afternoon. I'm in the backyard having a kid's birthday party, you know, for one of my kids. And he calls and I answer it. And I'm like, oh, hey, Rudy, I've got my kid's birthday party. And like before I could say, can I call you back? He like just launched into what he wanted to talk about. Like, he didn't really care, you know, what was going on. And so I faced that. And, you know, Rudy and the culture of that company, Conexa, it was a 24/7 culture. And part of it was, you know, it was a venture capital backed company growing fast, and there was a lot to do and everybody was wearing a lot of hats. Part of it was a global company. So we had offices around the world. So it wasn't unusual that, you know, doing a meeting on the phone at 11 o'clock at night, your time was 11 in the morning, someone else's time. So there's never an ideal time. But in these cases, I mean, I think it's, as we were just talking about, like, I think it's wrong of the boss, wrong of these companies to do this for especially long stretches of time, because you want people to rest and recover. You don't want to lose your best people. It's not about the number of hours you put in. It's about the work you get done, right? So we know all this, but none of us are going to change our boss's mind. Like, we can't go and say, dude, stop calling me at home on the weekend, right? And as I mentioned last week, Tara, you know, the thing as the individual that we do need to remember is it is a competitive world. So even if it's wrong, if you and I have similar roles and the boss is calling us both on the weekend and you're always picking up and taking that call and I'm never picking up and taking that call, who's more likely to get the promotion? Who's more likely to get the bigger raise or the bonus? I think you need to realize if that's the culture you're in of that company, then you need to adapt to the culture or maybe go find a company that's got a different culture. You know, I think a lot of bigger, more established companies probably don't have, you know, these kinds of crazy around the clock hours and weekend time. And, you know, I think when we're job interviewing, we want to know what the job is, what we're going to be doing. We ask about the pay. We ask about the salary. We are interested in, you know, who we're going to be reporting to. Is the boss, you know, is she nice? Is she not nice? I think we need to think about this work-life balance or culture question, because once you're in, I don't think you can change it. It's like, ignore it, don't respond, but realize you're stunting your career, or do it and realize you might be hurting your, you know, your family life a little bit. But I don't know. What do you think, Tara?
It's a tough one. You know, I was thinking about it earlier, and it is similar to my friend's situation, and it's tough because as an employee, you don't have a lot of power to reverse a dynamic that's already been established like that. You know, I'm personally a big believer in confronting things, and I know confronting sounds aggressive to some people, but I literally just mean something like, hey, you know, I missed your call last night. I'm really sorry. Is there any way we can keep late night calls between like 5 and 6:30? Because sometimes I have stuff to do. Or, you know, I'm big on talking things out. But depending on your relationship with your boss, that might just not be a real possibility. So like you said, the only real choices you have is change your response to it, your reaction to it, or change your job, unfortunately, because it's hard for one single employee to change a whole company's dynamic if that's how they're working. So it is a tough spot to be in. And I totally get it. Like when you're in that position too, you feel kind of helpless. You're not sure what to do. But really those are unfortunately your only choices. I think you're right.
You know? Well, I would add to what you said, Tara, is in terms of confronting, I mean, maybe an in-between step from like I'm saying, like, suck it up or leave, and you're like, hey, confront them, is I liked where you started. You could always, instead of saying, hey, don't call me on the weekend or don't call me after 7 o'clock at night, you know, maybe it's like, hey, sorry I missed your call last night at 8. I usually shut my phone off around 7 p.m. just to, you know, focus on the family. You know, sorry about that. And like, let them know what your practice is, or, oh, sorry, I didn't pick you up over the weekend. I try to leave my phone, you know, behind and focus on downtime or whatever. So like, I think most bosses, they're like in this case would be driven, and that's just going to be their behavior. But it could be that, you know, they don't have kids. And so they don't realize people who do have all these other things going on, or their kids are older and they forget what it's like when the kids are younger, or I don't know. So I think maybe just letting them know, you know, that you're focused on, you know, family time or downtime or whatever. Maybe if they're a cool person, that they would get the hint and it'd be fine. I don't know.
I like that. I like the way you frame that. I also think you can kind of frame it in a sense being like, oh, I tend to shut off my phone after 7:30 most nights just so I can really recharge and come to work ready to go the next day. And then you just
hit the like go better faster than ever before.
Exactly. It's like, I like to be at peak condition and that means I have to turn off my phone at 7:30. You can frame it that way. And then it doesn't come across like you're complaining. It comes across like you're trying to be your best. So there's nothing wrong with that. But good luck with that, Rin, and reach out with us if anything changes. Next question is from Charles. It says, you talk about using handwritten thank you notes as a way to motivate your employees. How often should each employee get one? My boss says one thank you note per employee each quarter is best.
I hate to be so direct on this, but having a quota for thank you notes is ridiculous. It's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. So the whole spirit of like thank you notes are magical, handwritten and everything. It's awesome. But it's the spirit of recognition, showing appreciation. And so you should do it whenever it's deserved, and it's deserved more often than most of us think. Like it's, you just need to catch people doing things well, doing things right, putting in the effort. And then you should thank them as close to the, you know, that behavior or that event as possible. And whether that's a verbal shout out, hey, thanks a lot, high five, or an email or a handwritten thank you note, you know, if someone's doing something amazing every single day, thank them, show that you appreciate them every single day. Doug Conant was the CEO of Campbell Soup. He turned them around. They almost went bankrupt, and then they were thriving after 10 years. And he really focused on employee engagement. And, you know, one of his tools was he's just a big believer in these handwritten thank you notes. So at the end of every day, Doug Conant handwrites 10 thank you notes to employees. They say that in his 10 years, I can't remember the number, but it's like 10,000 or 30,000, some ridiculous number of thank you notes that he sent to his employees. And he never had a system that was like, uh-oh, I'm at the end of the quarter and Tara didn't get her note. What can I thank her for today? It's not like that. It's like, who's doing cool stuff today? Who's having an amazing week? I'm going to thank them. And whether they get, you know, a bunch of notes in the quarter or only one a year, that's just the way it goes.
Yeah, as you know, Kevin, I'm knee deep in feedback research for our next book. So, sincerity is going to take you further than quantity. It has to be genuine. It has to be something you actually appreciate and sincerely want to thank someone for. Otherwise, you know, like you said, you're just kind of like, thanks for bringing in donuts that one day. That was really nice. That's not going to come across the same way. So like you said, quotas are not the way to go. But I would also emphasize, if you focus more on effort, on your employees' effort, you will, I think, naturally end up writing more thank you notes. Because if you're kind of motivating people and inspiring people by being like, I saw how much work you did on this, that's amazing, I love how much passion you're putting into it and how much time, then people are like, oh, great, all right, they like my work, they like my effort, and that will kind of take you further as well.
Hey, that's a good reminder because, and again, when I was young and management dumb in my 20s, I actually flipped it around and I said, look, you know, we're all about results. And I thought it was a good thing to say, I don't really care how you get the results, you know, so get them and we're fine. I don't care if you show up 5 hours a week if you get those results. And there's some truth to that. But if you want to create a culture that fosters innovation, creativity, you need to encourage risk-taking. So there will be a lot of times when people will give huge effort, but then that project fails, that experiment fails, you don't get the sale. And you got to make sure people realize, like, it's okay. Like, we're not going to win them all. And so I think that's a good reminder. Like, you want to look for, you know, hard work, effort, creativity. If anything, celebrate the failures too. It's not just looking for those results. It's the effort, and then you'll see that much more often.
Exactly. Perfect. Anyone on Facebook Live currently, if you have a question, now would be a great time to go ahead and ask one. If you don't, that's fine too. In the meantime, I'd love to chat about who we have coming up next.
Yeah, who do we have? I'm always forgetting what calendar week we're on with these.
Me too. They're all running together. But next week we have Gary Brackett, former Colts player, NFL Super Bowl champ.
Super Bowl champion. This right? is a fun interview.
Really and, fun. Yeah.
Great guy.
Great guy. Has some awesome tips. And he talks about kind of retiring from the NFL and having this time where he just wasn't sure kind of what to do with himself. And so, of course, like most people do, he decided to go back to school and get his MBA and become an entrepreneur, which is crazy. But his story is amazing. So that's coming up next. And then we have Connie Tang, who is the president and CEO of Princess House. And we actually split this interview up into two parts because it was a bit more in-depth and extensive, but she talks about everything from, you know, her childhood and, you know, early failures in business and how she got to where she got today. And it's really great. And I found it really inspirational too. She really had a great way of looking at opportunities, right? Yeah. Well, they're kind of disguised as more work. Yeah. But I thought that was great. So that's going to be in two-parters. And then we're going to have a Throwback Thursday episode with Dori Clark, one of our more popular episodes, all about finding your own unique brand and exercises to get really specific about it. So super useful
I just got an email from Dori about an hour ago.
Really?
She's got a new book coming out. I'm now blanking on the title, but I'm sure we'll end up having her back on the show. She, well, Tara, this is right up your prior life. She's been experimenting with stand-up comedy and is friends with James Altucher, who's been experimenting with stand-up comedy. So she's doing her book launch in Manhattan at a comedy club. And she and James and then professional stand-up, you know, comics are going to be there. I thought that was a clever, fun way to launch her book.
It's fun, and it's really interesting to me that so many comedians and stand-up comedians and improvisers kind of get into the leadership circuit and vice versa. So it's an interesting dynamic.
Are you insulted by this? Like, you know, it's kind of...
No.
You know, someone who, like, studies it and has done all this stuff, and then you got, like, a bunch of wannabes, like, oh, yeah, I'm going to open my eye. I heard a joke from Uncle Tony. I'm going to tell it. Like, do you think, like, look, this is a serious art form. Like, stop doing that.
You know, I really don't. And the reason for that is because it's such a punishing career choice. It's such a punishing hour of your life, if you're lucky, or 10 minutes of your life. So anyone who has the guts to go up there and, because pretty quickly, you know, that joke that Uncle Tony told you falls flat, the panic sets in and you get the sweats and you're shaking and you're like, oh, they're giving me the light, gotta go. And you're, you know, running off stage. So I don't fault anyone for trying. It is really tough, but it is really fun and it's incredibly invigorating. So if anyone out there wants to do stand up, please do it and tell us your experience because it's a great way to put yourself out there and get out of your shell a little bit.
We'll have to do some like LEADx charity show in Philly or something. Some you can organize an open mic and get some friends and everything. We could do something like that.
I can dust off my old set. Yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
It won't be super topical anymore, but
I was gonna say, do we have to be more clean, or would we have to bleep it if we recorded it?
No, actually, I don't think I have any swears in my stand-up, oddly enough.
Okay, good.
I can get pretty swear-tastic on my off hours.
Your mom would have like watched it or something, and like you'd get a hold of it.
I'm not sure if she's seen my full set, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mostly she hasn't seen the mom jokes.
Oh, actually, no, there is a mom joke, and I did tell her, but she loved it. She thought it was so great. My family, the first thing they asked is, like, are there any jokes about me? Like, they wanted to be mocked.
It becomes
public.
A family roast.
Yeah, it really is. And then no one else is laughing except this one table with my family. That's a great way to approach comedy. Just make it really personal.
Everything is an inside joke.
Yeah, yeah. No, I was like, you know, I do have a joke about you, but it wasn't at her expense either. It was kind of making fun of our Canadian heritage. So in that way, I think she kind of dug it. But no, I think it's great. I think it's a great thing to do. I think everyone should get into improv and stuff. It really loosens you up, you know, and opens you up. Cool. So go Dori. That's exciting. But yeah, that's what we have next week.
Did I just throw you completely off your game? Did we have anyone else for next week?
No, that was awesome. This is the perfect segue. I think we did that really smoothly.
Um, Tara, I'm going to take a look here. Our friend Anthony is sharing. Let's see. It's a little long, so I'm not going to be able to put it up on the screen. But let me see if I can read this out for our listeners. I'm going to be taking direct control of a store in our company for about a month coming up soon. That is to help retrain the staff that have not received proper training from managers before. Our current manager is new and worried about me sort of displacing him. Do you have any tips for how to make the process a bit easier and to ease his concerns? Tara, boy, this really throws it at us on the spot here.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. So Anthony, and I don't know if we're going to have time for you to actually answer this, but you could try through the comments. Like, I'm wondering, are you replacing the current manager, or you're just going in to do some training and then popping back out? I mean, I guess that's the first thing that, you know, comes to mind. And, you know, if he's going to be staying behind and you're popping out, I mean, they're going to have to realize he's still, you know, the leader in charge. But the more that you can involve him in that training so that people realize that, you know, he's got, you know, skills and talents and knowledge and stuff too, and a lot of this is coming through him, I think the better. And then in the spirit of, I'm going to channel Tara here, of just being direct, is, you know, maybe huddle with him ahead of time and say, you know, whatever, you know, are there any concerns? How do we make sure that this doesn't come off the wrong way to the team members and stuff? And just give him a chance to know that you're being mindful of that and to actually hear him out in case he's got any, you know, any concerns about it.
I agree. I think communication is the best form of, you know, kind of nipping things in the bud. You know, if you want to say, hey, I'd like to collaborate a bit more with you, I want you to feel comfortable, I don't want to step on your toes, I think people appreciate that. And if there are tensions later on, hey, at least you brought it up beforehand and they had an opportunity to talk to you about it. So I think that's probably a safe way to go.
Cool. Thanks, Anthony, for being on the live show and for sharing what you got coming up. So friends, before we wrap up, don't forget to go to leadx.org/subscribe to, of course, subscribe and rate the LEADx show on iTunes. It's the number one favor you can do for us. It really helps us to build the LEADx family. And then go to leadx.org/askkevin to submit your question for the show. And Tara, on that note, we survived another show and didn't get kicked off. Like, it was a little sketchy there in the beginning.
We didn't get kicked off, and we didn't go wildly over time either. I'm very impressed.
We're getting better. We're getting better.
We got that brass ring.
Nice tie back, Tara.
That's right.
All right. Until next time, remember, leadership is not a choice because leadership is influence. We are all leaders all of the time. You influence in one direction when you speak up in that meeting, when you give advice to your kids, when you do something that makes your marriage stronger. And you influence in another direction when you sit silently in that meeting, when you don't have an honest talk with your kids, and when you let your marriage run on autopilot. So don't be a bystander. Be mindful with your influence. Please lead with intent.